Our panel discussion, The Writing of History Without Bias. The panelists are Dr. Hamida Khoro, Dr. Jean-Luc Racine, Dr. M.R. Kazmi, and Dr. Parvez Hoodboy. The moderator is Alex von Tonzelman. And actually, I'll just hand over to the moderator, Alex. But before we start, I would like to thank the French Consul General, Mr. Christian Ramage, who's with us here today, and the French Embassy for supporting us in this panel by sponsoring the visit to Pakistan of Dr. Jean-Luc Racine, who has come from Paris, and also of Dr. Michel Boivin, who will be speaking in a session on Sufism today. So I just want to acknowledge the support of the French Consulate and the French Embassy. Thank you.
Right, everyone turn their microphones on. Welcome to The Writing of History Without Bias, a session at the Karachi Literary Festival. Thank you very much for having us here. Thank you to Amina Saeed for organizing it and for all of you for coming. I think we're starting more on time than even I was expecting. So hopefully we will kind of have a lively session today. I'm hoping to have quite a back and forth debate. So I'm going to be jumping in and then we're going to talk for a bit and then we'll have questions at a certain point. Or am I inaudible? Always good to start off being inaudible. The writing of history without bias, I mean, this is a question that when I saw on the sheet that this was going to be our subject, the first thing you study if you go into a history degree at university is that the first assumption that is given to you is that actually all history has bias of some sort. To have it without bias is impossible. Even if you have a list of facts and dates unadorned, nonetheless the selection of those facts and dates is a form of bias in itself. Napoleon famously said, "What is history but a fable agreed on?" That actually, in a sense, history becomes a kind of coalescing story from lots of different sources. And here in the subcontinent, there's been kind of a particular interest in history without bias because so much of the history that's come out about events like partition has been very much slanted one way or another. There are strong political interests around a lot of history that also kind of pull it one way or the other. Of course, not having bias or being dispassionate, if you like, if we want to use a kind of more neutral term, is not the same thing as not having opinions, and I'm hoping we're going to have some opinions today on this panel. So without further ado, I want to start with Jean-Luc Racine and ask, what do we mean by unbiased history?
Well, in fact, you said it, no one knows is there such a thing. And of course, it's not something specific to the subcontinent. It's something which is, the question is valid absolutely everywhere. It's linked to what's happened also everywhere, which is the construction of national mythologies, of what we may call the grand narratives. Of each nation, and if I'm myself something of an expert on South Asia, I may introduce perhaps some remarks coming from my European experience, but not as an expert on Europe, simply as a European, and particularly as a French. And of course, working now for quite a number of years on Pakistan-Indian relation, it seems quite easy to shift from that to the Franco-German relationship. The parallel might, of course, be valid, but only up to a point, precisely because every country or every set of countries have their own specific histories, their own background, their own mythologies, if I may say so. And it's not quite sure that what we may learn about the process of use and misuse of histories that have been deciphered as far as European history is concerned. Is easy to translate from one continent to another one. But nevertheless, it's quite clear that what we may think about what has been the established official histories for decades during a time of repeated wars, and of course everyone knows that the kind of wars which were fought between the French and the German have nothing in common with what have been the war between India and Pakistan. The war between India and Pakistan has basically been short. The last two wars between France and Germany have transformed themselves in global war in a way. Nevertheless, what's really fascinating is how after the Second World War, statesmen and decided that enough was enough, and that it was time to rethink relationship between two countries. And of course, for rethinking relationship between two countries, you have to rethink the established histories of the two countries. Nevertheless, it's a process which is taking quite a lot of time, you know. Those who planned the kind of reconciliation between the French and the German started their work as early as 1950. But the first common historical textbook co-published by a French and German publisher, co-authors by French and German historians, has been published only in 2006. So it took almost one generation for historians being able to work together. And here again, we come back, of course, to something which is extremely important, something which has been underlined here in Pakistan almost 20 years ago by K.K. Aziz in his book, The Murder of History, about the absolute importance of what is said and not said in the textbooks. And that's why, in fact, the first real milestone in the history of the bilateral rethinking about history between the two countries has been textbook. Later on, quite a couple of years ago, there was also, and I'll stop with that, a very interesting book co-written by a French and a German historian on the First World War. And here it's very there is a point which has to be underlined. In a way, it was easier to rethink the Second World War because the Second World War was basically a fight between fascism and the rest. While the First World War, 1914-1918, which has been a real butchery, was a war against nationalism. And it's much more difficult to rethink national history and their drift than to rethink the big fight of the 20th century between the fascists and the Democrats. I'll stop at that because there is so much to say. That,
there is. This subject is quite massive, actually. Pervez Hoodboy, how close are we to a joint India-Pakistan history?
Well, I thought I might make some comments about interpreting history through the filter of the mind. The mind is a cognitive system. And those who study cognitive processes, they tell us that there is a complex system of filters that operate, that exist in the mind. Actually, this is very necessary because otherwise, whatever information we would get would be a complete mess. It'll be just a jumble of facts which then could not be interpreted usefully. So we have to have something like an operating system, something like, let's say, Windows or Mac or Linux or whatever, that organizes the mind so that it can usefully categorize facts and put them into appropriate places. Sometimes what happens is that this operating system can become deformed or malformed. And then the categorization of facts then leads to amazing nonsense in the interpretation of history. To be fair to everyone, let me give a number of examples. The Israelis believe that they came to a land. The slogan of the Israelis was, as they took over Palestine, that this was land for people without a land, as if no one else lived over there. To give another example, in spite of the fact that Al-Qaeda and Saddam Hussein were at war with each other, and Saddam Hussein had tried to kick out Al-Qaeda from there. Nevertheless, 50% of Americans believed that, in fact, Saddam Hussein was friendly with Al-Qaeda, and therefore Iraq had to be attacked because of that. Well, more close to our neighborhood, let's look at the issue of Babri Mosque. There are even Hindus with PhDs who believe that Lord Ram was born at the place of Babri Masjid, and so therefore Babri Masjid had to be demolished. Well, coming to Pakistan, the malformation or the deformation is even greater. We can look back into our history and see example after example where objective truth and the perception of truth are miles apart. Let's take the issue of the separation of East Pakistan in 1971. If you were to ask the man on the street today, why is it that East Pakistan separated? The most probable reply that you will get is because it was a Hindu conspiracy, because there were Hindu teachers who poisoned the minds of young Muslim children in East Pakistani schools, that there was a conspiracy which was hatched in India, that Mujibur Rahman was an Indian agent, and so forth. They will perhaps not even listen to you when you say that, in fact, the Bengalis are an independent people who, even today, do not want to join up with West Pakistan. They believe that they were mistreated, that they were exploited by the West, and that they had genuine grievances. That sort of perception, that sort of understanding is absent among not just our school children today, but among even senior educated people.
If I can move
whatever.
On to, sorry, to take the question to Professor Kazemi, I'd like to ask, so conspiracy theory in history, it's something that's a big feature of history in much of the world. Do conspiracies rush in where history is biased and inadequate?
Well, let me start with a few observations of Professor Racine. You see, he mentioned Peter Gale's Napoleon For and Against. And the debate about the origin of the First World War began first in the winning power in Britain itself. You know that there's a debate between Trevor Roper and A.J.P. Taylor about the origins, in which Taylor tried to depersonalize the whole causes of this Second World War. And of course, we need to rethink our history, and as he said, Parvez Hoodboy here, that there are distortions. I've been teaching history for more than 30 years, and let me tell you one thing, that the official textbooks, which were written during the Zia era, which I would really call the Ronald Reagan Zia era, because what we faced were textbooks given to secondary school students or college students. But the books Kathy Gannon has mentioned, K for Kalashnikov, J for Jihad, what I want to say is that we are not naturally terrorists. We have a floating population of a neighboring country in our country. And that conditioning started, and it's rebound on us, it's rebound on everybody. And today, if we make a serious effort, I've tried my best. I've been teaching for 30 years. I did it as a professional obligation. I brought out a book. And I've tried to tell the whole truth. If I say that my book is error-free, I'll be indicted for blasphemy. But I've made every human effort. You see, one thing you must understand, I was taught by Urdu teachers, Hindu teachers in East Pakistan, and I can confirm what Dr. Hoodboy is saying, that none of my Hindu teachers preached this session in any way whatsoever. The more chauvinistic were the Muslim teachers. But then their interaction with the students was also very, very positive. My teachers in Dhaka University, Dr. Fatima Hassan Sant, she taught me the history of South Asia, Dr. Sufia Ahmed, and well, I think that she imbued in all her students, not only me, all her students, how to write history without bias. We were conditioned to it. We can't obliterate everything. About East Pakistan, there are two things that you must remember. Number one, people forget that the elections were held to a constituent assembly on the 2nd of May 1970, I think it was, at Hatia, Sheikh Mujibur Rahman himself said that the coming elections was the framing of a constitution, not for the transfer of power. And it was a constitutional crisis, because Bhutto is a particular bête noir of our historians. So that aspect of it is sort of a hidden to put obloquy on him. But yes, that is one mental block in our understanding of our own history, and it should be resolved. Dr. Hamida Kuro, she used to teach in the Department of History when I was a student, and she resigned over the atrocities committed against the East Bengalis. So it's not absolutely a mindset which has everybody in its grip. Thank you.
Thank you. At this point, I'd like to bring in Hamida Kuro, who I know has a strong interest in school textbooks. And in the interests of non-biased history, I'm going to point out now that Pakistan is not the only country with a problem with biased textbooks. Last year, the Texas School Board voted to replace the word slave trade in its textbooks with Atlantic Triangular Trade. American imperialism is removed from textbooks and replaced with expansionism. Capitalism is removed and replaced with the words free enterprise. So this is not a problem confined to this country. Dr. Kuro, I know that you're working on books for children about the history of Sindh.
Yes.
How do we go about addressing this problem at an early stage?
I haven't worked that out myself as yet. But I must say, it must be taken as axiomatic that there can be no history without bias. Because with best intention of the in the world, a historian is a person brought up in a certain culture with certain beliefs, certain, and so on. And those do creep in. I have written, apart from the children's book, I wrote a biography of my father, which of course everyone assumed daughter's his version. I went to great pains to verify everything twice and thrice, you know. But even then, I would say that people who read it would say, okay, this is the daughter writing, you know. So that is difficult. The other thing is that any history is written, if it, as was mentioned about the wars between France and Germany and from various others, any history written by, you know, after a war, let's say, or anything, is always written from the point of view of the victors. So there's no question, the defeated are always marginalized. So you don't get the whole picture, anything. Perhaps the earliest text, earliest narrative in the history, ancient history, belongs to the subcontinent, the Mahabharata. Now, Mahabharata was, I suppose you could call it a epic poem or something, but that again is extremely biased in favor of the victors, even at that time, in 1500 BC or whatever. It was still very much a victor story, and even the god Krishna is taking sides in this thing. So if you get this tendency from 1500 BC, there's very little chance that you arrive at a neutral sort of sense now. And for children, really, I've tried extremely hard to be as neutral as possible. But the other thing is that there's the difficulty for the modern historian who relying on documents to be able to read those documents. You have to be able to read the documents because you have to go into the motives of the writers, you have to, and for this, the latest theories of deconstruction really, you have to go into the layers of writing, you have to examine the motives, each statement, where does it come from, what is behind the statement, and so on. So it is that if you're going to write a history with that kind of, objectivity in mind, I don't know if you can produce a volume even in a lifetime, but that's what the latest demand is. The other thing from this point of view of the subcontinent writers, of course, we have a huge, huge wealth of historical writing. Not only do we have the ancient texts, we have the first written history of the subcontinent was from Sindh. And okay, so quite a lot of it is romantic fiction and so on. But this is the book, the Fateh-Name Sindh, written after the Muslim conquest. And in that, for the first time, you get actual historical documents are given in that history. And so that, you know exactly, I mean, there can be no doubt that this was written by the Hajjaj bin Yusuf from Iraq to Muhammad bin Qasim. These are his instructions. They're given in detail as and when the documents are given. So we have got a very, not only a wealth of histories, but also some really good principles in those. There is, for instance, the medieval history that has been written here. You know, the Mughals used to have historians writing their every accounts every day in their courts. But they also had newsletters from each district, each taluka of the whole empire, coming in to bring all this information into the center. And so if the historians of that period have had all this material, you know, we know about Abul Fazal and so on, but actually there is, even if one knew that now, if you know Persian, if you know those things, you could still go into this and produce social and cultural histories for which there's immense material, but which nobody has written. Unfortunately, the emphasis has always been on political history, and that always, of course, seems to be biased. But if there is material for cultural histories and social histories in this country which could be written, the great turning point in the history of the colonized world really came with Edward Said's Orientalism. Now that, I think, has now, you cannot write history of this part of the world without taking that into consideration. He showed that the West had, the colonizing West had objectified the East, you know, all those romantic paintings of slave girls and harems and so on. And also, but had the real intention perhaps was to show that these were really primitive, innocent peoples who needed to be, civilized. The great example of this, I think, would be Robert Louis Stevenson's Man Friday, you know, in Treasure Island, the innocent native who is taught from by the white man. So I would say the most influential and the most comprehensible also, and he was not even a historian, he was a professor of literature. Edward Said is perhaps the most influential, in my view, man, for at least for people who are writing about history of third world or colonized world or whatever.
I'd like to pick up on that point about Edward Said, you know, an absolutely crucial writer when you're writing about this part of the world from the West, particularly. You can't not read Edward Said. But we're still in a situation where a lot of the kind of at the front of the bookshops, a lot of the big selling books on South Asia are being written still by Westerners. I mean, you know, I'm kind of guilty myself of that, and people like William Dalrymple, Patrick French, Martin Gilbert, Stanley Walpert. You know, why is so much of South Asian history still being colonized by white folk like me? I'm going to put this horrible question to Jean-Luc Racine and make him responsible for it.
I don't believe that I'm really responsible for that, for the good reason that I'm not an historian myself, so it's easy to escape from the blame. I would like to, amongst many other issues which could be addressed, take a leaf from what Dr. Amida Kourou said about colonial or post-colonial history. Again, with the French experience, a few years ago, in the French Parliament, a section of the MPs tried to have a law passed stating that despite, of course, what criticism we can have about French colonization, particularly in Algeria, everything was not black with colonization. And so there was a great debate about that, was saying, well, colonization has to be totally pushed aside and rightly criticized. It's a part of the necessary post-colonial rethinking about what the past was. And it ran up for a few weeks or months, till the day when the French president, Jacques Chirac, decided that, there would be no law about that, because it's clearly not to the legislators to write history and to decide to pass judgment of what history was. And of course, and here I'm far away from the point I touched before about Franco-German relationship, here we deal with our own French national history, with its black spot, how colonialism was carried on. There is also a big issue about, for instance, the slave trade. Who was responsible for the slave trade? And obviously, it's easy to show how the French companies in the 18th century prospered by a trading slave from Africa to West Indies. But at the time, there was also a French historian, a very serious academic French historian, who underlined that, of course, whatever have been the responsibility of the European trading companies in slave trade, they were also in West Africa Arab slave traders and local kings, African kings, who indulged themselves in the slave trade. It was enough to publish a book like that in a prestigious publisher. You know, it was not at all a kind of polemics. It was a serious history. And there was a movement against this historian by a number of associations from French national, but immigrated either from West Indies or from Africa, saying that it's absolutely a shame. The real responsible for the slave trade were not the Arabs or not the black kings. It was basically the European trade companies, because of course the European trade companies were the most important actor of the slave trade. But this is just to say that, of course, a couple of centuries after that occurred, it's still a matter of debate. And even today, and it would be my last point as well, there is a debate in the country about the need or not to have a museum on French history. This is a proposal which has been set up by the present president. And immediately, the corporation of historians divided itself. Those being ready to play the game to add an additional museum in Paris, and those saying, no way, we shall not participate in a state decision to build up a new museum on national history because we don't want to officialize in any way what history is supposed to be. So let's history to be the preserve of historians, but not just of historians, because by definition, history is a matter of debate. And I think it's extremely significant to the point where we are now. You know, probably a few decades ago, there would have been a kind of consensus for saying, yes, we need a kind of new museum about the national history. Now it's not something which can be easily decided, precisely because now everyone understands that there is no history without bias.
Pervez Houdboy, I'd like to pick up on a point that Jean-Luc Racine just made, because we're talking there about different French versions of a history of the slave trade, but you know, it's one thing for the French to fight themselves about it, but is it meaningful until we have, say, a Congolese history of the slave trade, a Senegalese history, a Ghanaian history of the slave trade? Do we actually need to redress history by having people in post-colonial history, people in the countries affected by this writing history?
Well, there's a fascinating book called The Writing of History by E.H. Carr. Mm. I read it a long time ago, but he asked the question whether, in fact, you can write history objectively in that manner. Well, perhaps you can, but then you have to have an understanding of the world that relies upon your subscribing to science and to a scientific way of thinking. Perhaps then one is able to record facts and put them into a framework that is coherent and that is consistent with numerous observations. We've been talking about European wars. I want to make the point about wars that have been waged on this subcontinent, because those are of the greatest interest to us. Mm. Pakistan and India have gone to war in 1948, 1965, 1971, and then in Kargil in 1999. And yet there's a total difference. There are absolutely different narratives about that war. Is it possible that there can be one narrative about this? Is it possible that we could arrive at some set of facts that we could mutually agree upon? Let me tell you how different it is. In Pakistani schools, it is taught that all the wars that Pakistan has fought were purely defensive wars. That we were attacked in 1965, that we were attacked again in 1971, that is when India broke up Pakistan into two. But the 1965 war in particular, I think, is very interesting, because that is shown as a defensive war in which India attacked across the border and was just about to take over Lahore, and so Pakistan had no alternative but to fight back, and that it essentially won the war, but that the war was stopped by Ayub Khan, else we would have had a victory over India. Well, if you look at what the other people in the Pakistani establishment have to say, like Air Marshal Asghar Khan, they have a completely different narrative on this. They will tell you that, in fact, this was Operation Gibraltar. It was an attempt to cause the Kashmiris to rise up, and the sending of Pakistani commandos over there would be the catalyst for this. So here are two completely different ways of looking at the same historical situation inside Pakistan. So although we talk of how history has been recorded over the ages, but this is something that is contemporary. And if we cannot agree on the contemporary, then surely there is little chance of agreeing what has happened in the distant past.
On the other hand, I mean, to respond to that,
can I just say that it's impossible to do current histories. Histories have to be written at least 50 years after. So when you are saying, you know, Pakistan-India wars, you can't get objective, neutral opinions now. You have to wait for that. 100 years from now, maybe, yes.
Well, I was going to come
back with
Chew On Lai's famous quote about this. Chew On Lai once said that he was asked whether the French Revolution was a success or not in 1789. They asked him, of course, in about the 1960s, and he said it was far too early to tell. I think also, I mean, certainly when I went to university, we weren't allowed to study anything after about 1900 because they just said the papers weren't available. I mean, most governments have release dates on papers and documents that mean that you can't get them for at least 30 years, usually 50 or so on. But I'd like to come back to Professor Kazemi on this question. Can we write a current history?
Well, I think we can, but Dr. Hood-Boy has mentioned the 1965 war. Let me tell you, it's one of the most curious wars in history. Initially, both sides claimed victory. Subsequently, both sides admitted defeat. Mirza Aslam Beg, chief of army staff here in Pakistan, Admiral Nadkarni in India, both admitted that their countries had fared very badly in the 1964-5 war. So you have a consensus, but we have a consensus that we can't do anything with. And yes, we can write. You see, it's also a question of knowing your signifier, because Dr. Hood-Boy mentioned Edward Hallett Carr, and he makes the basic point that every fact is not a historical fact. And instead of facts propping up interpretations, facts are like an empty potato sack that unless you put interpretations in it, the facts will not speak. So, well, all right, we are chauvinistic here, the Indians are chauvinistic there, and the Bangladeshis are also chauvinistic there, everybody is chauvinistic, but then it's possible because the records are there. And I think if an Australian or a French historian were to take over the records from both countries of the 1965 war, then yes, contemporary history would be possible. Why not? I would think so.
Dr. Kuro, if we don't write contemporary history now, are we not in some danger of actually losing the facts of what went on, especially with media like oral history, which has been very important, I think, you know, is being done now quite well on partition, for instance?
Well, you can, obviously there's record. You have to have record of everything. I mean, as I said, even in the medieval period in India, the facts were recorded. Facts as they were known, wherever they were recorded. The question is that you can't have a real assessment of the events until sometime afterwards. Now, for instance, the history of partition on both sides is just emotional and prejudiced. You can't read about any writer who has written about that nearer time with any degree of, you know, this is really objective, because that's all on one side. And there's so much emotion involved in that you really can't have objective history at that time. So I think the children now growing up in Pakistan and India, they have a much more objective view of feeling about it. They want to know why did this happen and that, and they're not overwhelmed by personal experience. So you can expect from them some objectivity and perhaps good writing, history writing, but you can't expect it from people who've gone through that experience. So I think it's good to record things. I'm sure it should be written about, But don't expect that to be objective history.
So should we not expect your book about your father to be objective history?
It's a record of facts.
I'd actually like to move to the audience for some questions now to get this debate going, if we may. Who wants to start off? We have one over here. Can we have a microphone over here, please? I'll come to you next.
It's been wonderful listening to everybody's views expressed in such an erudite manner. However, most of the panelists just confined themselves to the subcontinent. They just talked about mutilation of history in the context of the subcontinent. Now, what I would like to ask is this a purely phenomenon that's restricted to the subcontinent? What about the Americans? 63 years ago, when they dropped the atom bomb over Hiroshima and Nagasaki, since then, American history books have been telling us that they did it for the sake of peace, which is a very sloppily contrived lie. Actually, the reasons why they did that was, firstly, they wanted to snatch world leadership from Britain through sheer balance of terror. Secondly, the Soviet Union was about to invade the Japanese Far East, and the Americans didn't want the Japanese to surrender to the Soviets. These were the reasons why. And if you will, what about the black hole of Calcutta? It is nothing but a figment of a very underdeveloped imagination. So is this phenomenon just confined to the subcontinent, or is it worldwide?
Pervez Hoodboy? Oh, of course, Professor Kazmi.
I think Masudur Rasin and Pervez Hoodboy, we gave examples to show that bias in history was not confined to the subcontinent. But since it affects us more directly, we started concentrating on that. And one thing more that you should see that Madeleine Albright in her memo to the president-elect, she stated one of the reasons why there's so much conflict in the world is that nationalistic history books cause chauvinism to be nurtured in every country. So it's not that we are excluding, she mentioned Napoleon for and against. It consists only of French historians. German historians are not included in that. You have a number of such debates that, I mentioned A.G.P. Taylor and Trevor Roper, so it's not that we've been confined to the South Asian subcontinent. But yes, I'm saying there are misconceptions, and there are two types of misconceptions. One are deliberate misconceptions, and then there are other misconceptions because we haven't been able to channelize the chaotic mass of historical literature. So you can blame us for the first, please don't blame us for the second.
There was a question.
Just a quick addendum on that. There is another kind of history, and that is Marxist history, which is different from history written out of nationalistic motives. For example, the explanation given by Marxists for the First and the Second World Wars is that this was related to capitalism's need for exporting capital. In other words, imperialism was the highest stage of capitalism, according to Lenin. Now, that's a different way of approaching history. It seeks to find objective reasons. It seeks to find the material reasons for what causes war, what causes development, and so forth. That, I think, is an entirely separate chapter, but a very interesting one.
Can I please go to this lady who had her hand up first in the purple shirt? I'm sorry, behind you, actually. It's just that she had her hand up at the beginning. Just four rows back. No, just behind this lady. Can you stand up, please? Thank you. I'll come to you next. Sorry, it's just...
Yeah. This question is coming, it's based off what Dr. Hoodboy said about scientific approaches to history being the way to go about it. And as a student of history, I actually have serious reservations about approaching history from a scientific point of view. And a lot of us go towards history rather than political science, because not because we're studying the past as opposed to current affairs is because we seriously disagree with the methodology. So I just want to know, don't you think there's enough evidence that you can't necessarily get the most comprehensive understanding of historical events or, you know, human experience through certain scientific methodologies?
Pervez Hudbo, would you like to respond to that?
I didn't quite get the question.
Oh, could you repeat? Sorry, we need the microphone back.
The sound system is not very good over here.
Yeah.
Please
I'm
speak as clearly as possible.
What part did you... Did you not understand the whole question, or
no,
did you not hear the whole question?
You couldn't get it.
You didn't. Okay, I'm saying the part you said that, you know, scientific approaches to history, studying it from a scientific point of view, will give us the most kind of clear answers or a better understanding of it. So I'm saying, as a student of history, I have serious reservations about scientific approaches. That's why some of us move towards history rather than political science, because it's not because we're studying the past rather than current affairs. It's because we seriously disagree with the methodology and want to take a different approach to understanding human experience.
Well, one can take two very different points of view. One is that history can be codified into facts, that there is only one history. And you can take the other extreme, which is that that history has to be entirely individualized and personal, or perhaps based upon groups, that each group will look at history in a different way. Now, if it is true that no objective recording of history is possible, then that means we would be an utterly fragmented community not just of individuals in a nation, but of nations themselves. So there has to be, the truth has to lie somewhere in between. Yes. Those filters of our mind, they do determine how we arrange the facts, but those arrangements cannot be too different. Otherwise, the extreme point of view would be that we wouldn't be able to agree upon anything at all.
Can I now move to the lady at the front, who I just deprived of her question?
I have a general observation that while writing history, the writers, the historians are not always been biased about the events, but the group of people or a majority of people, like women are missing from the history. And even there, where they have played some very constructive and very positive role, like history of culture or history of literature. And it is general phenomenon in the world. So any one of the speaker can answer on it.
Yes, Samita?
Well, I think that's a very valid point. In fact, the conventional history is now being overturned, as it were, and narratives of women, of, Africa, of areas that have been marginalized so far are now being looked at, and especially women's movements and so on have helped a lot. And I think this is the current trend, that the marginalized people are now being, you know, recorded, and histories are being written for Africans particularly, because of slave trade, and Africans in America, in the U.S. and so on, are very much aware of this, and they live in a society where of course history is very important, and important historians are writing it and so on. So they are aware that they themselves are marginalized, now very much involved in the narration of the African, you know, that famous book Roots, it made people aware that there is a history there of people of the Western world, that is. Of course, the Africans knew there was a history there. But it has the world is now paying attention to these histories and to women and so on, I think.
There's a lady at the back who's had her hand right up. Yes, just there, thanks.
Good morning, my name is Tahira Abdullah, and I was going to ask about the missing women from her story as opposed to just history. That question has already been asked. So I would now like to make a plea for linking the corrections in removing the distortions and biases in our joint history with India, along with changes in the curricula in civics, social studies, and bringing in peace studies, civics, and human rights, and environmental conservation studies into the curriculum, along with removing distortions in her story and history. Thank you.
Thank you, and we'll take a question from Dan.
May I answer that?
Yes, certainly.
The last chapter of my book is about human rights in Pakistan.
Can we take a question down here, please? Yep.
Will WikiLeaks make history more authentic?
What?
Oh, I love this question. What? Will WikiLeaks make history more authentic?
Your question, please.
The question was about WikiLeaks and will it make history more authentic. I actually have to say, if I can make my own comment on this, I'm very distressed by WikiLeaks because what worries me is that now they'll write very boring cables because they think they're going to be leaked. And actually what I make a lot of my kind of meat on is the terrible things that people say when they don't think they'll be overheard. So I'm very worried that it's now going to be self-censorship. Does anyone have anything else to add on WikiLeaks?
Well, actually WikiLeaks was very much, you know, it's sort of knowledge that was already current. Everyone knew that this is so. WikiLeaks has just sort of corroborated some of the stuff that was already well known. And we had our own WikiLeaks during Ogren Zip. There was a historian called Khafi Khan, and he used to write a whole lot of stuff which was, you know, not really acceptable to the courts and so on. So we've had our own WikiLeaks, but this is okay. I don't think that is that crucial to the writing of history.
Another one, this lady just at the front here.
History, I think, is a very important area of human development and civilization. I've often come across, and right now also in the discussion, that should history be taken from the nation state ever since, or history should be beyond and before that as well to address the biases issue? When we start history from context of a nation states, then I think a lot of history is already lost. What I mean to say is that how we focus people to look at history not from only from nation state point of view, but it's beyond that if we talk about history.
Well, I think historians are looking well beyond that, actually. I'd say, but would anyone, Jean-Luc Racine?
No, well, I can pick up this one, of course. And you are absolutely right, of course. And it's something which does exist, obviously, but I don't know exactly at what time of national histories it's possible to go beyond national histories. But it's quite clear that now histories have gone much beyond the stage of building the national narratives. We have historians which are, the big change, in a way, has been, as far as Europe is concerned at least, taken perhaps 30, 40 years ago, when a new brand of historians decided that the traditional history focus on the kings, the emperors, the state was to be there, but that it was time to look at the people as well. And looking at the people was, it's something which is of course very difficult because quite often the records which have been prepared or written as far as the state power is concerned. If we look at the subcontinent, it's clearly what the subaltern historian, basically in India or from India now in many American universities, have started to work on trying to go beyond official records for finding out what was the life of the people as far as possible. But we may go I mean, there is no end to the way of rethinking the way of conducting historical studies. You have people who are working on, for instance, the history of a family. Going up to the point to say, well, the family as we know it, in its various forms, it could be the nuclear family, it could be the joint family, but it's basically whatever we may believe intimately, it's an historical construct, because if we go back to 5, 6, 7 centuries back, the relationship between the wife and the husband, or the relationship even between the mother and the child, was different. So it's not to, to pick up from a very important point that Pervez Houdboy mentioned. We don't have necessarily to be afraid about the destruction of a kind of common history. I mean, the various way to conduct historical studies must, of course, not end by building very separate histories. So the real challenge is, how do you contribute to build up a sense of community without drifting to a kind of hyper-nationalist history? And that is a challenge everywhere.
Professor Kazmi, do you have anything to...
Quickly comment on this. Yes. I think it's a very important question, but Dr. Hamida Khoro has already alluded to it, that history is the narrative of the victorious, as written by the victorious, not by the vanquished. There's a marvelous book. It's called A People's History of the United States, written by Howard Zinn. And this, for the first time in the United States, has tried to change the way in which the history of the United States has been recorded. Not from the point of view of the founding fathers, of those who came from Spain and Europe, but from the point of view of those indigenous peoples who were eventually eliminated and conquered.
Well, there's another thing I would like to add. Mm-hmm. You asked whether we should begin with national history. Now, let me tell you that as far as Hajjaj ibn Yusuf is concerned, in Middle Eastern history, he's a villain. In South Asian history, he is a hero. Now, how can you logically begin the history of Pakistan with 711? You can't. Because let me tell you one thing more. Because the first Arab settlers, who were also the first Muslim settlers, they were not only welcomed, but given high offices by their Hindu hosts. There's nothing in the religion of the Hindus. You see, Hinduism as interpreted by Gandhi, or Hinduism as interpreted by Deshbandhu Chittaranjan Das, and the Islam practiced there in South Asia as a whole, that was not actually a thing that was mutually exclusive or inimical. A lot has happened. We are writing subaltern history, but let me just mention two factors. Jinnah's personal friendship with Motilal Nehru and Jawaharlal Nehru's standoffish attitude to Jinnah was what made things that were bad enough much worse. Much worse. The partition of India is controversial because the partition of India was avoidable.
A point that I'd love to pick up on, actually. It's a fascinating discussion, but we've only got time for one or two more questions. The lady down here was...
Bela Raza Jamil. Fascinating, absolutely. Puts up three or four critical issues. One is, what is the demand side story of history? I mean, we are talking from the supplier side, but from a demand side point of view, taking into account Pakistan and a kind of an official death of history in schools has led to general silence, and there isn't a demand that is emerging in spite of the fact that there is an entire shift in the so-called paradigm of education, saying that now we need to go into constructivist methodologies of education and learning. But there is a kind of a disconnect between saying that and actually acting upon that, because if that was so, would we not have what Aisha Jalal says, the method of history, which would be used cross-cuttingly across every subject? So that's
one question will do. Thanks. If I could put that to Hamida, because
the demand of the students is to get fresh ideas, a fresh look at what they've been taught. That's, I think, and it's the historians and the government. And I was asking Tahir Abdullah, maybe she's influential in Islamabad and can get the textbook boards and get the ministries to really give, because it's the federal government which gives the textbooks and decides on them, that they should really get something neutral and something more like history to be given to schools than what we are getting now. So there is a huge demand, there's no doubt, among intellectuals, among students, and so on. But unfortunately, in this country, it's really up to the government, to the Ministry of Education, the federal government, to give that thing. Now, when I was a minister for a short while, we were really looking into textbooks and revising them and taking out all the repetitions and the boring stuff. And a lot of good work was done. But I don't think that those textbooks have still been introduced into government schools. So there has to be a huge will among the people, and the demand has to be greater than it is now.
I'm very sorry to say we're going to have to draw this to a close, because otherwise we're going to make the next session very late. There's so many interesting questions come up here, and I know that several people here, I'm sure, would like to add and respond. But I think people will be signing books and be around, so perhaps anyone who has further questions to ask can collar one of us later on. Thank you very much for coming and attending. Please enjoy the next session, and a round of applause for the panelists.